At the time when Israel was divided into two kingdoms, a king named Jehoshaphat, the ruler of the kingdom named Judah, heard the two armies were on their way to attack his kingdom. So Jehoshaphat told the people of Judah to fast and pray to God for help. People from every town of Judah gathered at the temple in Jerusalem to pray. Jehoshaphat stood up in front of everyone and prayed. He asked God to show them how to avoid the oncoming attack. "We have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us," Jehoshaphat prayed. "We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you." All of the people of Judah, men, women, and children, stood and waited for direction from God. Then God's spirit directed a man named Jahaziel to share something. "Do not be afraid or discouraged," he told the people. "For the battle is not yours, but God's. The armies of Judah should take up their battle positions, but God will fight the battle for them." Early the next morning, that's exactly what they did. Jehoshaphat encouraged the soldiers and all the people, "Have faith in the Lord your God, and you will be successful." As the opposing armies marched towards them, Jehoshaphat instructed a group of men to sing to God in worship. As they began to sing, the two armies that were coming to attack Judah suddenly began fighting one another. They completely destroyed each other, without the people of Judah ever having to fight. Finally, they returned to the temple in Jerusalem to praise God by playing harps, trumpets, and other instruments. As other nations heard about what happened, they were so fearful that they didn't dare attack Judah, and the people of Judah lived in peace during the rest of Jehoshaphat's reign.
Good morning. Welcome to New Hope Community Church. It's great to have you with us today in this Sunday preceding Thanksgiving. I'm glad you came out to join us as we offer Thanksgiving to the one who gives us all good and incredible gifts. I don't know what your needs are that brought you here today, whether you're a regular that we see all the time or whether this is your first visit here, but we are honored to have each and every one of you here. I'm not sure what needs you want to have met today. Here's what I can tell you. I can't meet them. Be honest on the front end, I can't do it. But I trust you will find the one who is present here today who can. And his name is Jesus Christ. In our imperfect way, we will preach in our a little less imperfect way than my preaching. They will lead us in singing, and I trust through the music and through the neighboring spirit that you might experience of those sitting around you, and most of all the presence of Christ in our midst, you will find your needs being met today. If you are visiting with us for the very first time, there are cards in the pew in front of you. Would love for you to take one out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag. Here's the deal. We're not going to bother you on the phone. We're not going to beat on your door, but through the mail, we'll send you information that answers your questions about New Hope Church. We'll do our very best to do that. You never know when we might put that in a lottery drawing and give away $1,000. It hadn't happened yet, but you just never know when we might start to do that. But we would love to know that you were here today. Thanks. Let me highlight a few announcements, some things going on out in the pavilion between the services, and then some prayer requests and praise items, and then we'll get engaged in our worship this morning. Ladies have an ornament exchange coming up on Monday night, December the 1st. You may get your tickets out here in the pavilion, all right? They may need to make sure that they have enough food and goodies there to take care of everybody, so tickets are available out there. Please, and this is the last day, last Sunday. Angel Tree, there are still angels out there to be plucked off the tree that you can make a difference in the life of a boy or a girl whose mom or dad's incarcerated in prison, and you purchase that gift in the name of the incarcerated parent at their request and also in the love of Christ. And so we try to meet both the relational need with family and the spiritual need with Christ himself as we give these gifts during the holiday season. And more information about all that is available out in the pavilion, and so please take up that opportunity. And those gifts need to be returned by next Sunday, all right, to either the church office or here at the church on Sunday morning. After the 10:45 service at about 12:15, somewhere in that direction, if somebody knows exactly where it's going to take place, let me know. The Women's Self-Defense? Okay, in the Bridge Building. Okay, in the Bridge Building, that's right out these two doors, and in the first door that you would come to on the other side of the pavilion is the Women's Self-Defense Class. For our visitors today, let me clarify something. This is not because this is an unsafe place to be that the women are taking a self-defense class, all right? This is because this is approaching a holiday season, and a lot of ladies are going to be out shopping by themselves while you are watching football games. And so just want to make them as safe as possibly can. And so one of the members of our church is going to be leading in that today. If you didn't sign up for it last week, probably it's okay if you just show up after the last service is over. They'll probably make room for you, all right? They would love to have you there. Kids play. Don, where are you? Stand up, Don. One round of applause for Don last week. Great job with our kids. She had a staff that helped her as well. Okay, now is that a CD or a DVD? Okay, very good. All right, DVD, so you can see them as well as hear them. All right, they were just awesome last week. Coming up on December the 7th, we are having a congregational meeting. This is a church-wide meeting, particularly for those who are members. If you've been here very long and you're a regular attender, know you are invited as well. But according to our state, 501c3 members, vote. But you're certainly welcome to come, ask questions, find out what's going on. But this particular reason for this meeting, because it's towards the end of the year, is to review our budget with almost the full year completed and to propose to you the budget for 2015 that's been prepared by our finance team and our elder board and our staff. And so would love to have you come and be in that meeting. Here is here's something I always like to be preventative if possible, all right? Want you to know it's a budget increase of about 12%, which is the largest increase we have asked for in a long, long time. We've usually stayed around 4 or 5%, all right? Now, that being said, now that the shock is over, that increase of 12% is less than what you have already given this year. Are you with me on that? Okay? So the increase seems to be pretty big, but we're not asking you to go beyond what you've done already this year. And so in some ways, the way we could say that is it's really kind of a faithless budget. You understand what I mean by that? I don't mean that tacky, but it's the flip side of the other coin is we're not stretching it, but we did stretch it. All right. So we want you to come and hear about what's going on. There are some important things that we need to do this next couple of years, and we'll also bring you up to date on where we are in our construction and remodel projects, and those should be kicking off the ground right around the 1st of January. Some prayer requests. This has been a challenging week for a lot of families in our congregation. The Linares family, Patrick's father's memorial service was this last Friday, so if you'd remember to pray for them. John Mansfield's grandmother passed away, and her service was this past week, so please continue to remember to pray for them. Jim Watson, one of our board members here at the church, his brother-in-law, Harley Phillips, passed away, and neither Jim nor I knew he was even in the hospital. He lives in Bakersfield. They brought him up to Fresno. His family lives out of town and out of state, and nobody let us know. His memorial service is going to be the week after Thanksgiving week. Lynn Lewis. Lynn and her husband Mark and their two little boys, those boys used to run up and down these aisles and over the pews, and they were just crazy. They're now young men, and they're just wonderful young men. They moved out of the area, the state of Washington, but Lynn's dad was an anesthesiologist at St. Agnes Hospital until 1989. He retired from there. His name was Dr. Jack Hodge, and his service was here yesterday. So if you'd remember the Hodge and Lewis family, they would appreciate that so much. And then Jim Gritchfield, he is no longer in room 357 at St. Agnes Hospital. Jim's room was ready in heaven, and so God called him home to himself Thursday morning about 3 o'clock. And so continue to pray for Kathy. She is here this morning, and she is doing remarkably well. And her small group is all right there on the pew with her, and that's what small group is all about, to help at moments like this. Part of us were there Wednesday night. Jim probably had his best hour that he's had in about 2 weeks during part of our time together on Wednesday night, and we were so grateful for that. Hospice was going to be coming in the very next day and getting things arranged for him, but God had better plans. And so we rest in that. His service has been scheduled for Monday, December the 1st. Not this coming Monday, not tomorrow, but a week from tomorrow, December 1st, 2 o'clock, right here at New Hope. Reception following will be at Classic Catering in downtown Clovis. Here's the deal. We expect this to be an overflow crowd, not only because of his connection with New Hope Church, but he's a retired PG&E guy. He did an awful lot, had an awful lot of customers after his retirement that he took care of, and was well-loved and appreciated. So what I'm going to ask of our New Hope family, you can get here early and get a good seat, okay? But if it fills up, I'm going to be asking you to do the kind and gracious thing and to move outside those doors and go over into the bridge. The screen is there, the projector works, and you'll be able to see and hear everything over there and allow guests to New Hope to be able to sit in here, all right? So just kind of giving you a heads up on that. But continue to pray for Kathy and the family. Mikey Zumwalt had to go back into surgery yesterday on her knee. She had infection in it, and so they need to go in and clear the infection up. She is at Clovis Community Hospital, and she'll probably be there until tomorrow afternoon or Tuesday. So please remember to pray for Mikey. Sarah and Blaze Gottfried, a young couple in our congregation, they have some very special needs and circumstances going on, some very challenging times for them, and I would appreciate you remembering to pray for them. Carolyn Gilmore. Has had pneumonia, was in the hospital for a few days this week. We didn't know about it, but I got an update today. She is home and she is improving. Janice Dunnington, part of our 8 o'clock. As you know, Ed passed away less than 2 months ago. Janice no longer lives in her home where she lived with Ed. That property is being sold. She is now in a assisted living, all right, off of Shepherd and Willow. And she's probably going to need transportation coming to church. You're saying, yeah, but we come to 9:15. If you have any interest or availability and could help out, whether it's one Sunday a month or one Sunday every couple of months, and she would probably be willing to come to 9:15 if that's what can be done, or if you might be willing to come to 8 o'clock one Sunday a month, put your name and phone number on a card and say, assist Janice Dunnington, or contact Gene Sperling. He has the information, the address, and we're going to do our best to make these kind of arrangements. As you know, she has she's got some personal challenge. She gets around physically fine, all right? But just be praying for Janice, and if you can help out, that would be great. Amy and Brandon Snavely, a young couple in our church, praise item, they gave birth to a brand new baby girl this week at Clovis Community Hospital. This is a real blessing for them. Their first baby was stillborn, and we had that service about 2 years ago. And so this is their first child, and she is well and healthy. She weighed 6 pounds, 14 ounces, and was 18 inches long. And they have now gone home, and they are quite thrilled and excited about the new developments in their life. So those are just a few of the updates that we wanted to bring to your attention. There is a book. Along with the Believe Bible, which is out on a table, there is a book that will be available that if you would like some terrific reading. This is a book that I read about 12 to 14 months ago for the very first time. I've read it 4 times since then. Most of you know I'm a pretty voracious reader. I have a top 10 list, and my top 10 has pretty much been the same top 10 books for over 10 years, all right? And probably 7 or 8 of those top 10 books I read 20 years ago. This one has made the top 3. This, I think, is one of the best books I have read in a long, long time. It's called All In by Mark Batterson. He pastors in Washington, D.C. This book normally sells for $22.95 at the bookstore. When I told Harry how much I liked the book, he called me a few months later and said, I got a deal for you. So since he had a deal for me, I have a deal for you. This $23 book, you can pick up off a table out there for one of 3 prices. Would you like to guess what prices those may be? $10, $5, or free, all right? Your call, all right? You just go and pick one up. Now, it's kind of, it's the honor system, all right? It's the honor system and paying for it. There should be a basket or a box out there by the books. If not, just toss it on the table. Now, what's free if you choose not to pay 5 or 10 for it is the book. You get my drift? In other words, don't take the $10 bill that might be on the table. That's not available for you to pick up, just the book, all right, if you want the book. And actually, you'll hear a couple of quotes in this morning's sermon, all right, about that. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, if they would at this time, and come to wait on us as we have our tithes and our offering. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father in heaven, I am so grateful for the life that you share with us. It is a life that you share with us in this world. And we share that life with you with great hope, filled with promise that one day we'll experience life with you where you are. You come to share life with us right now where we are, and you promise us in the midst of a world filled with trouble that our heart doesn't have to be troubled. You tell us in a world that often is confronted with grief and sorrow, that our grief and sorrow is real, but it can be overcome by joy and hope. You promise us, Father, peace in spite of war. You promise us internal peace in spite of external conflict. And so, Father, we are very grateful to share this quality of life here on earth that you offer to us. So we trust you with the needs of those who have arrived here today with sorrow, with struggles, with fears, with aggravations. And I pray that, Father, in the time we spend focusing our attention with a sense of single-mindedness on you, that this incredible transcendent God will enable us to be transcendent over our circumstances and situations. And sorrow will find comfort, and grief will find joy, and pain will find relief, and struggles will find peace. And so we thank you for the promises you offer to us. We surrender to you the needs of those who are facing health challenges, whether in the hospital or now out of the hospital. We pray for those that you will use out of the fellowship of New Hope to visit, to encourage, and to pray. Thank you for the privilege of giving today, Father. We give our gifts today, not so that New Hope can be a better place, but Father, we give here today so your kingdom can advance, so that your fellowships will flourish and grow, so that children will be born into your family. And so thank you for the privilege of giving as generously as you have given to us. We trust you for all our needs. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you want to get ready in advance, Matthew chapter 6 is where we'll be focusing our attention in just a little bit. Matthew chapter 6. It was a little over 100 years ago, an entire century, that a band of brave souls became known as one-way missionaries. They purchased single tickets to the mission field without getting a return ticket home. Instead of suitcases, they packed their few earthly belongings into coffins. As they sailed out of port, they waved goodbye to everyone they loved and to everything they knew. They knew there was a high probability they would never return home again. A.W. Milne was one of these missionaries. He set sail for the South Pacific, knowing full well that the headhunters who lived there had martyred every single missionary before him. Milne did not fear for his life because he had already died to himself so that Christ could be alive in him. His coffin was packed. For 35 years, Milne lived among that tribe, and he loved them. And when he died, tribe members buried him right smack dab in the middle of their village, and they inscribed on his epitaph, on his tombstone, these words: "When he came, there was no light. When he left, there was no darkness." When did we start believing that God wants to send us to safe places to do easy things? That faithfulness is holding the fort and playing it safe is safe. See, Jesus didn't die to keep us safe. He died to make us dangerous. Faithfulness is not holding the fort. It's storming the gates of hell. It's time to quit living as if the purpose of life is to arrive safely at death. The will of God is not an insurance plan. It's a daring plan. The complete surrender of your life to the cause of Christ, that is not radical Christian living. That is the normal Christian life. Is yours normal? It's time to quit living as if the purpose of life is to arrive safely at death. It's time for us to go all in and all out for the one who is the all in all. Pack your coffin. Let's go. Incredibly powerful words, huh? Wish I'd written them. That's the entire first chapter of this book. I probably just reduced the sale of the book. I've never had a book move me like this one. I encourage you to pick it up today. But you'll find it dangerous. But as we said here often before, the safest place to be is in the center of the will of God, wherever it takes us. Today we are in week number 14 of a 30-week series called Believe. Our first 10 sessions looked on the key truths of the Bible, those truths that we build our life on. We have a choice in life today. We can build our life on a solid foundation of God's truths, or we can build our life on, as Jesus described in the parable, shifting sand on the culture of the times in which we live in. And when the storms of life come, it's going to be the foundation that will determine how well we do when the storms come. I can tell you for a fact where Jim and Kathy Critchfield had built their life these last 3.5 years. And I can tell you the difference it's made in Kathy the last 72 hours. What are you building your life on? 10 key truths. We are now almost to the halfway mark in the second section of 10 called the 10 key practices. If we believe these truths, there is a corresponding practice to each one of those truths that help take that truth become real in our life, which in time will take us to our last 10 subjects, which are the 10 key virtues of Christ that wants to be revealed in us. When we believe what is right and we do what is right, the character of Christ will be demonstrated in us. So today, we are on key practice number 4, and it is single-mindedness. Good. How many of you read your chapter in the Believe Bible? You were better than the 8 o'clock crowd. They were weak this morning. All right, they were weak. They got scolded just a bit. If you do not have a Believe Bible, you can pick one up out there. The price is the same as those books, $10.05 or free. All right, you could walk out of here with 2 free books today. Okay, just don't walk out of here with 2 $10 bills. Okay, we're all okay. And that first chapter I read to you out of Mark Batterston's book, I don't think I've ever read anything that was as single-minded as that in just a few paragraphs. So let's unpack this idea of single-mindedness. Webster defines this term: single-mindedness is having only one purpose, one goal, one interest, focused on one thing. an applied biblical definition, and what that simply means is I've taken Webster's thoughts along with biblical truth and I put together a definition for our working time today. Single-mindedness in this context means surrendering all of you to all of Him. It's a simple recognition that every second of time and every ounce of energy and every penny is a gift from God and for God. What do you think the opposite of single-mindedness might be? You want to give me some options, some words? If we're going to look at the antonym of single-mindedness, what jumps in your mind? What was that? Double-minded. Oh, good. I like that one. They didn't give that one to me at 8 o'clock. Way to go. Unfocused. Good. That's another great one. Anything else? Schizophrenia? Well said, Gene. And Elmer. And Marty. Yeah, and Elvis, yeah. Hey. Anything else? Diversiveness, all right. How about this one to go along with that one? Scattered, okay. Scattered. Distracted. One last one. How about absent-mindedness? Have any of you ever been plagued with that? With those thoughts in mind, let me ask you another question. This is not to be answered out loud, and this is to be only answered by yourself for yourself. Okay? You are not answering this for the person sitting next to you. Okay? You are answering this solely for yourself. How would you assess your attention to Christ in the adventure of your daily life? From the time that you wake up in the morning and you eat your breakfast and you go to work and you share in your hobbies and you interact with your family and you make choices to pay your bills and you make choices to buy stuff and you end up at the end of the day on the side of your bed getting ready to go to sleep, how would you say in the context of that adventure, how was your attention to Christ during that day? What words best describe it? Would it be single-mindedness? A recognition that every second, every ounce of energy, every penny is a gift from God and for God? Or would the term absent-minded be more appropriate? What does that word absent-minded literally mean? It means having or showing a habitually forgetful or inattentive disposition. Remember, not out loud. And not for the person next to you. Would the word scattered be appropriate? That means disorganized, disorderly, or diffused. It happens. Scattered would be a good description of my desk at the moment. Okay? It's a bit disorganized, disorderly. Is that your thought process of Christ? How about the word distracted? Distracted means often panicked or inattentive or far away. It's there, but it's often the distance. Which one of these words best adequately, not what you want to describe yours. I think the vast majority of us, I could be safe in saying, I think most of us in here would like ours to be single-minded. But what's the reality? What's the reality? And know also that with this word single-mindedness, there are good forms of single-mindedness and there are bad ones. Here's the difference. A bad single-mindedness is when a person becomes so preoccupied that they lose all grip with responsibility and accountability. This is obviously a form of self-delusion, and we often label these personality types as self-centered, self-obsessed, and just downright selfish. These are folks who wear the t-shirt, "It's all about me." That's a bad single-minded person. A good form of single-minded is the ability, in spite of all the distractions of life, to block out erroneous thoughts in order to focus best. So I have another question that I want you to answer out loud with me. All right, help me with this one. What are the distractions in our world that disrupt our single-mindedness or make us a bad single-minded person. What are the things or the distractions in our world today, 21st century, that disrupt our single-mindedness towards Christ? Cell phones, all right? Before I get a plethora of, I love it when I can use that word. But how about if we lump into that all technology, okay? So we don't have to go to Facebook, computers, and, you know, okay. So all technology would be one thing that is a distraction. What else? Work, okay? Work and careers. Kids, family and relationships. What? Health, okay, good, health. Okay, sport, okay. May we just throw in all sports, okay? All right, you're starting to meddle now. Okay, all right, but you're absolutely correct, sports. Me time, politics, okay. Okay, yeah, the husband and wife kind of tandem there. All right, we'll call, how about if we call those hobbies? Yeah, both of those, me time and hobbies. Now, with all those answers, excluding politics, because that one would change this question. Are any of these wrong? That was a little subtle humor about politics there, okay? two of you got the subtleness, all right, and the rest of you, okay. Sports, careers, relationship, family, hobbies, technology, any of those things wrong? No, not in the least. And I don't want them removed from our lives. But these things, when they become distractions, when they become the thieves that steal our single-mindedness from Christ, then they become wrong. See, playing soccer and baseball and basketball is not wrong unless those things become a distraction from Christ in you. Playing basketball, participating in band or choir, pursuing careers and hobbies and family doesn't stop a Christian from being all in. But if while we are playing and participating and pursuing those things, we will not be silent about our faith in Christ if we are single-minded. We will not be sloppy about life's choices. We will not be shoddy in our practice and participation in those areas, and we will not showboat our successes over others if we are single-minded. We can play all those sports, we can participate in all those activities, we can pursue those career and family things, and we can still be all in, but we won't be silent, sloppy, shoddy, or showboat. And let me tell you how I came up with those four words. I thought of Jim Critchfield Thursday afternoon as I was working on this. 3.5 years ago, when he got his life squared away with the Lord, Jim's life changed. Jim continued to do his activities, his hobbies, his vacations, his career as a retired electrician for many of us. He's really ticked me off this week. I got a light in the parking lot that's out, and the bulb's going out on that projector. Jim's the only one that had the stuff to reach all that things. So, who's going to become his replacement now? But here's the deal. Jim would go into somebody's home who he had been referred to for some work, and he would do the work, and he would hand them the bill. Jim was known to say to them, "Do you know Christ? Do you go to church?" And if they would say yes, he would say, "You don't owe me anything." Remember, he was retired. I'm not saying those of you who are in a career right now, you can just say, "Don't pay me," all right? He would also say, if they said no, he would say, "I'd love to have you come to New Hope Church on Sunday. I'll save a place on my pew." And there were a lot of times, as that pew was full today, there were a lot of times that was filled with others that Jim had brought in from people he had worked with, people that he knew, and people who he had said, "If you come to church on Sunday, I'll tear the bill up." You see, he found a way in both his hobby and in his career and in his family life not to be silent. He wasn't sloppy about choices that he made. I had a coach one time at Fresno State tell me, and this was a gentleman who believed in Christ, but I had him tell me, he said, Tim, when I had an athlete that I had got to come to my school, and when I found out he had become a Christian because he had gone to FCA or something, I cringed. Because he says that said their level, their quality of play diminished more often than it increased because they became a little careless. Well, okay, because Christ is most important. Baseball is unimportant. And that's not what Christ does when he comes to live in our life. When Christ comes to live in us, our career doesn't become unimportant. Our hobbies are not unimportant. Our family life is not unimportant. They are just less important than that which is most important. And we find a way in which that which is most important, single-mindedness, has its expression through us, and I ought to become a better husband. You ought to become a better wife because of this relationship with Christ. Our kids, when they come to know him, there ought to be a difference in the way in which they live. When we engage, and it's always, I'm always a little nervous when I pick somebody out of kind of a celebrity status and use them as an example because next week you'll read about them in the Inquirer. But I've had a deep appreciation for the last 5 years for Derek Carr. I've had a deep appreciation. When he was on the top in the college arena, he was still humble, but he played with great intensity. You never saw that intensity wane. I've now seen him lose 11 games in a row. Guess what? You never saw a change in his intensity. You never saw a change in his demeanor. You never saw him discouraged by the losses. And he worked hard. The intensity was still there, and yet he continues to honor the one who lives within him. He found a way through sports and career to stay single-minded. I've heard Carr, he and his brother both say, my life is not defined by football. I am not a football player. I am a Christian who plays football. Do we have that kind of definition in our own life because of being single-minded? You see, our sport, our career, our hobby, our family needs to be the platform for our passion and our purpose in Christ when we are single-minded in our approach. A pastor participating as one of the beta churches like we are in this Believe series that we are doing right now. A few weeks ago when we had a conference call together with Randy Frazee, he shared an example from his childhood. He said a pastor, probably on a yearly basis, used to give us five simple points. He'd take his hand, point one, two, three, four, and these were five secrets that leads to a victorious Christian life. Five secrets that I would suggest to you improve single-mindedness in our lives so we can live this victorious Christian life. And I thought they were pretty good, so I'm going to share them with you right now, all right? Five secrets. Use your hand here, all right? All right, put your hands up. Come on, guys. Show me a hand. All right, go to your thumb. Go to your thumb. First moment of every day. First moment of every day. When your alarm goes off, you're going to give God your first thoughts? Okay? How can you do this? So, Tim, I'm not wired that way. Okay, put a Bible right next to your phone. My phone's my alarm clock. I don't know if yours is, but whatever your alarm, put the Word of God right there so you see it. All right. If that's not big enough, write a note. Start the day with God. First moment of every day. Second finger. First day of every week. What's today? First day of the week. Good. I'm preaching to the choir today, aren't I? All right? First day of every week. First dime of every dollar. Oops. Yeah. First dime of every dollar. First thought of every consideration. First thought of every consideration. First love of my heart. If I love him preeminently, I will love her better. If I love him preeminently, I'll figure out a way to love you. Okay? It's key. First moment of every day, first day of every week, first dime of every dollar, first thought of every consideration, first love of my heart. Wow, single-minded focus. That would enable the truth of the psalmist David in Psalm 34, 37, verse 4, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Do you know how most of us want to translate that verse? When he gives me the desires of my heart, I will delight in the Lord. It's the wrong order. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires. There's this transformation that takes place when we hang out with Christ. When we hang out with him, the more we hang out with him, the more our life is changed. Have you guys ever known, have you ever known a guy who was a bit crazy? Okay, he was just wild, you know, young man, just, you know, going nowhere, you know, heading for the, and then he met an incredible young woman. And I see some women looking at their men right now. All right, yep, that was him. Yeah, and all of a sudden, they had someone in their life who transformed them. Why? Because they had a love for the person they were spending time with. And that love created this transformation. And that's what happens when you and I learn how to delight ourselves in the presence of God, spending time in his word, let his word working and soaking into our lives, spending time with his family, getting acquainted with them, and all of that begins to fill. Guess what? Our desires will be transformed. So now those things that young man that was taking him on a road to nowhere, his desires are now changed because his desires are coming in line with the desires of the one who loves him. And that's what happens with us. Let's take a closer look at what this looks like in Matthew chapter 6, beginning at verse 25. Actually, I'm going to back up just quickly to verse 19. This is a classic passage where Jesus is preaching. He said, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven." In other words, have a single treasure. Be single-minded in the treasures that you're putting aside. And then he goes down in verse 22, "The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are good, your whole body will be full of light. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness?" I think what Jesus is saying is not only have a single treasure, but also have a single vision. Let the light of my life be that which shines in and through you. And then verse 24, no one can serve two masters. You can't. You're going to be dysfunctional if you are scattered with your loyalties. One master. So have a single master. And then jumping in at verse 25, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life and what you eat or drink, or about your body, what you wear. Is not life more important than food and body more important than clothes? Look at the birds. They don't sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you by worry can add a single hour to their life? Why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They don't labor, spin. Yet I tell you that even Solomon, all of his splendor, was dressed like none of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, and it's here today and tomorrow thrown into the fire, will not he much more care for you? Oh, you of little faith. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? And I know some of you are saying right now, where are we going to eat? It's not what, it's where. Verse 32 is important. If you underline your Bible, underline this when it's thought-provoking. For the pagans run after all these things. So here's the question, what are you running after? What are you running after? That'll show you where your single-mindedness is. What are you running after? Let me pause right here. This doesn't mean you sit at home and God's going to dump, you know, a Macy's clothesline in your living room. This doesn't mean, you know what, I'm just going to sit at the kitchen table and God's going to sit down filet mignon. This does not avoid the process that you and I are to be allowed to get away with being lazy. So I want to, But do these things consume your attention to the point of worry? And he gives us some examples. You know, who can add an hour to their life by worry? In fact, psychologists and psychiatrists tell us you can take hours from your life as a result of worry. But verse 33 then gives us a single goal. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness and all of these things. The things, what are the things? The food and the fashion. Single-minded with Christ, these things God will provide. Don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has its own trouble of its own. And that has certainly been true this week. Because of our sinful nature and self-centeredness, we often start an endeavor with a mindset of what we want, and then we ask God to bless it. You ever done that? Okay, God, here's my plans. Now, put pixie dust on it, God. Make it turn out the way I want it to. We treat him like he's some kind of cosmic Santa Claus. This makes life about us, not about him. And Matthew 6:33 inspires a fully submitted to relationship in which God, his ways, and his plan are put first, preeminent on a daily basis, trusting he will do the absolute best for us in the circumstances this world throws at us. While what he does is always right, we will certainly not always agree with how he allows life to play out. Can you not agree with that? Quite frankly, I wasn't the happiest guy in the world Thursday morning. I was torn. I was torn. I didn't want Jim to struggle anymore. At the same time, I didn't want to say goodbye either. I was torn. This is where faith makes all the difference. Keeping our focus on his kingdom and his righteousness is what meant by being single-minded. I could say at the end of Thursday, God, thank you. Jim is with you. God, thank you. I will see him again. God, thank you. The struggle is over. God, thank you that on the day we celebrate him and honor you, our prayer is that others will come to know the Christ that Jim knew. It's vital to understand that these things in the second half of the verse have to do with the stuff that goes on in our life. Be single-minded about Christ and we will not worry about this other stuff. If we worry about this other stuff, then we are not being single-minded and we probably have every reason to worry. Jesus is letting us know that he's well aware of what we need. We should depend on him to provide. Dependence on him is a precursor to single-mindedness. That leads us to verse 34. Don't worry about tomorrow. There's enough going on tomorrow. Just think about today. Jesus knows that a single-minded person will live each day yielded to God's will and direction, just as he modeled for us in his own 3 years of ministry. Jesus placed God's will first, and it was provided for. This guy who didn't own a home, didn't own a chariot, didn't own a bed or a pillow. Yet the Father provided for the Son every single day. Ever heard the old saying, you can't have your cake and eat it too? This may well be one of the only situations in life where that statement is incorrect, because once you and I surrender to God and we are single-minded, we receive abundant life here and the gift of eternal life there. We get our cake and we can eat it too. Key question: how do we keep our focus on Jesus amidst all of the distractions of life? Single-mindedness points to and permeates all the key beliefs to think like Jesus. Just a couple of examples. One, he is God, I'm not. So the focus of my life should be on him. That's belief number one, God. The authority of the Bible has my attention, and the Bible should outline my priorities. That's belief number what? Four, the Bible. My priorities come from the one who is the owner of my life. That correlates with belief, number seven or eight, stewardship. Jesus is the ultimate model of what single-mindedness looks like. John records this, that Jesus said in John 4:34, my food, said Jesus, is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. If we are to act like him, we must increasingly surrender our minds and our wills to his will. Key idea for the day: I focus on God and his priorities for my life. I focus on God and his priorities for my life. We're going to do a little rehearsal. I'm going to quote the first half of that line, and I'm going to point to you, and you're going to repeat it. I'm going to say the second half of that line. I'm going to point to you, and you're going to repeat it. Okay? Here's the key idea for today. I focus on God and his priorities for my life. I focus on God and on his priorities for my life. A good place to start being single-minded about God is to evaluate and target areas where we may not be seeking him. Here is an exercise to help you with this. At the end of a day, take a few minutes to think back through your activities of just today. Try to recall your thought processes as you went through those activities. Try to imagine somebody shadowing you all day long. They've never met you before, but they are going to follow you everywhere you go. They're going to see everything you think and do. At the end of the day, what might this shadow say you were seeking by the testimony of your life that day? What would a stranger say is prominent in your life by the way you lived today? What were you focused on, and what would they believe were your priorities? Here is the startling good news about a relationship with God. He will never say to any one of us, "Well, I met somebody new today." God will never say that to you. Not once. Have you ever heard this line? "I just don't think this relationship is working out." God will never say that to you. God is all in with you 24/7, 365. He is constantly pursuing us. He seeks us all the time. He is single-minded about you and you and you and you. The great challenge for us is to remain single-minded towards Him. Yet when we fail, and we will, we seek forgiveness and move right back into a healthy, growing relationship with Him. As we mature in our beliefs and our knowledge of the truth, an ever-growing desire should be to simply love and seek the One who promises to never leave us or forsake us. Not because we want more blessings or favor, but solely because He is worthy of our full focus and attention. This is another strong indicator of single-mindedness. Pursuing God is the very first thing before anything else is a clear mission statement. When we get to that frequent questioning point of what is God's will for my life, Matthew 6:33 provides a steady answer. Single-mindedness is the answer to the search. Seek ye first and foremost the kingdom of God. Unlike an earthly king's physical realm, God's kingdom is only visible in the lives of His followers who are doing the very things that we are talking about. Seeking Him first. Earthly kings have borders and boundaries. God's does not. His kingdom is found in His people and His activity in them. As His temples on earth, wherever we move, His kingdom is represented. Do you get this picture? Okay. I know what Mike does for a living. And I know that where Mike works, the kingdom of God can be seen in the hallways of Farewell Funeral Home. I know where Keith Butterfield works. He fixes bad backs. I'm standing better today, Keith. In the hallways of his medical practice, the kingdom of God can be seen in him. On your school campuses, in the activities you do in retirement, in your delivery services, wherever you are taking the kingdom of God in your homes, across the hall to your son or daughter, down the street to your neighbor. You are the temple of God, expanding His kingdom. Do you ever think that way? I'm taking the kingdom of God wherever I go. Key application. What difference does all this single-mindedness make in the way in which I live? Number one, you and I should establish goals informed by God's agenda and God's will. If you're here and you're single, who you're going to marry ought to be the will of God. You have children, how you raise those kids ought to be the will of God. A change of employment, seek His will. He may say yes, He may say no. He say, hey, go for it. Hey, but do you seek His will before you make the decision? Number two, we don't ask God to bless our plan, but we seek God's blessing when I align my life to His plan. Number three, we trust God to meet our needs and desires, and we don't worry. God makes this profound promise in Matthew 6, and He offers a great blessing for being single-minded. He promises that if we trust Him, He will take care of His business here on earth, and He will take care of us both here and in eternity. Who else could offer you such an amazing deal like this? Let me lay the deal on a table in another way. Matthew says, seek first the kingdom of God. Here's how Paul talks about the same subject from a different angle. The Apostle Paul says, God made Him who knew no sin to become sin for us, so that in Him we could become the righteousness of God. Does that not sound like an incredible deal? Sounds pretty good to me. Here's the way that looks. The moment you and I bow our knee to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, all of our sin and gunk is transferred to Christ's account. And all of our debts are now paid in full. It was nailed to a cross 2,000 years ago. But guys, that's only half the deal. That's only half the gospel. Mercy is not getting what we deserve, which is the wrath of God. Grace is getting what we don't deserve, which is the righteousness of God. Aren't you glad for both sides? I don't want His wrath. I do want His righteousness, and that is His gift to us. Everything we've done wrong is now forgiven and forgotten. And everything that Jesus did right, His righteousness, is transferred to my account. And then you know what God does? He says, we're even Stephen. I love that. Even Stephen. Mark Batterson, another announcement, says it this way. The gospel costs nothing. We cannot buy it or earn it. It can only be received as a free gift, compliments of God's grace. So it costs nothing, but it demands everything. And that is where most of us get stuck, in spiritual no man's land. We're too Christian to enjoy sin, and we're too sinful to enjoy Christ. Ever been stuck there? We've got just enough Jesus to be informed, but not enough to be transformed. We want everything God has to offer without giving up anything. We want to buy in and not sell out. In December 2006, 18-year-old Katie Davis of Brentwood, Tennessee. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Brentwood. Best way I could describe Brentwood would be the Bluffs. Does that tell you something? Okay, that's kind of Brentwood. That's where she was from. She traveled to Uganda for the first time. She had no idea that the very course of her life would be changed on that trip, and her life would take on a razor-sharp focus in one small corner of the world. In 2007, Katie returned to Uganda to teach kindergarten in an orphanage. She was surprised by the number of children sitting on the side of the road or working in the fields. There were no government-run public schools in the area of Uganda where she was living. Most schools privately operated required fees for attendance, making it unaffordable for children to get an education. Katie began a child sponsorship program that matched orphan children with sponsors to provide education funding, school supplies, daily hot meals, spiritual discipleship, and medical care. Sounds very similar to what we are kicking off this February in a little village, an obscure place called Ivory Coast, Africa. By January 2008, Katie had brought 150 kids into the program. To date, over 600 children are now under her care. She also started a feeding program in a community to more than 1,200 children. They also receive schooling, medical care, Bible study, and health training. Katie established a nonprofit organization called Amazamia Ministries International to meet the physical, emotional, and spiritual needs of orphan children in Uganda. In the Lugandan language, Amazama means truth. In January of 2008, Katie became the mother of three orphan girls. Today, the mother of 13 adopted daughters. She says, people tell me I'm brave. People tell me I'm strong. People tell me good job. Well, here's the truth of it. I'm really not that brave. And I'm not really that strong. And I'm not doing anything spectacular. I'm just doing what God called me to do as a follower of Him. I'm feeding His sheep, and I'm doing it to the least of His people. Young Katie Davis' life is a bright example of single-mindedness and the amazing blessing God brought through its practice. She has no doubt when her feet hit the floor every morning that her life has a divine purpose and meaning. She knows the truth of Jesus' words. If you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you let your life go, you will save it. As we practice single-mindedness, something begins to change within us. The words of the psalmist become true. Take delight in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. The decision to follow God is difficult at first because His plan often conflicts with our plan. But when we focus on Him, He promises to give us the desires of our heart. Here's how it works. As you go through the process of focusing in God, He changes those desires so that over time, what we want for ourselves mirrors what He wants for us. A mirror at both ends. Keep that thought. No one can deny that our lifestyles are chaotic and complex today. Single-mindedness actually offers simplicity. Our lives can be uncluttered by the Creator and set on a path towards purpose and peace by His grace and by His mercy. And just before I wrap this up, let me give one. I always get a little nervous when I share an example like Katie's. That you all are going to say, Tim, I'm never going to go to Uganda, so I must not be able to live a single-minded life. That's not the purpose of the story. Here's the good news for most of you. God doesn't want you in Africa. God doesn't want most of us there. You see, if all of us went there, there'd be a wasteland left here. God probably is, for the vast majority of you, not going to change a whole lot of your daily activity. Because you take His kingdom into the places where you work and the neighborhoods in which you live and the restaurants in which you dine in. You are a representative of His kingdom there. What He really wants from all of us is that when we wake up in the morning, we wake up with a single-minded purpose. This is the day the Lord has made. What do you want to do with me today, Lord? And the steps that you have ordered for me today, I want you to be seen in me. Okay, wrapping this up. Mirror at both ends. Have you ever wondered what makes the difference between a spotlight and a laser beam? You ever just sat around your living room and thought about that? I did this week because I read about it. Reading's good for us. And as I first read this, I said, where are you, Jim? I need you to explain this electricity stuff to me. So here it is. Spotlight, laser beam. How does a medium-powered laser burn through steel in a matter of seconds while the most powerful spotlight can only make the metal warm? Both may have the same electrical power requirements, but here's the difference. Unity. That does not make any more sense to you than it did to me when I read it, does it? Hang with me. A laser can be simply described as a medium of excited molecules with mirrors at each end. And some of those excited molecules naturally decay into a less excited state. In the decay process, they release a photon. Remember what photon was? I didn't either. It's a particle of light. Particle. It is here that the unique process of the laser begins. The photon moves along and it tickles another molecule, inviting another molecule to join him on his journey. And now those two photons tickle two more, and they unify together on their journey, tickling each other. I can't wait, babe. Then these two photons tickle two more, and they invite two more, and they join the parade. Soon there is this huge army of photons marching in step with each other. It is this unity that gives the laser its power. A spotlight can have just as many photons, but they are not marching in unity. Each is going its own independent way, occasionally actually interfering with the others. As a result, much of its power is wasted, and it cannot be focused to do useful work. However, the laser, because of its unity, is like an army marching in tight formation, and it's able to focus all of its power on its objective. You're saying, Tim, why are you telling us this? One sentence. I wonder what would happen if the folks at New Hope Church had laser-like, single-minded, focused together. What might God do in our world? It's an interesting thought, isn't it? What might He do if we start tickling each other in unity to accomplish His purpose? I hope 5 years from now we can look back and say, now we know what God can do when just one church has laser-like focus about being single-minded with the purpose of God. Will you join me? Let's pray. Our Father, so much distracts us. Troubles, successes, possessions, hobbies, cares, frustrations, disappointments, life, death. All of us are going to face every one of those things in the adventure of a week. And we can face them scattered. We can face them single-minded. God, I pray that you will take this scattered life called Tim Rowland. And I pray through submission to your will, I'll become part of your laser that wants to accomplish your purpose in this world. And I pray there are dozens, and I hope hundreds, who will join me in the process, so that we can look back 5 years from today and say, wow, look what God did. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Out the side door, lots of stuff. If anybody's